Monetary policy is the process by which monetary authority of a country, generally a central bank, controls the supply of money in the economy by its control over the interest rates in order to maintain price stability and achieve high economic growth. In India, the Central Monetary Authority is the Reserve Bank of India, popularly known as RBI. It is so designed as to maintain the price stability in the economy. Other objectives of the monetary policy of India, as stated by RBI, are price stability. Price stability implies promoting economic development with considerable emphasis on the price stability. The center of focus is to facilitate the environment which is favorable to the architecture that enables the developmental projects to run swiftly while also maintaining reasonable price stability. Next, controlled expansion of bank credit. One of the important functions of RBI is the controlled expansion of bank credit and money supply, with special attention to seasonal requirement for credit without affecting the output. Next is the promotion of fixed investment. The aim here is to increase the productivity of investment by restraining the non-essential fixed investment. Next is the restriction of inventories and stocks. Overfilling of stocks and products becoming outdated due to the excess of stock often results in sickness of the unit. To avoid this problem, the Central Monetary Authority carries out this essential function of restricting the inventories. The main objective of this policy is to avoid overstocking and idle money in the organization. Next is promotion of exports and food procurement operations. Monetary policy pays special attention in order to boost exports and facilitate the trade. It is an independent objective of monetary policy. Next is the desired distribution of credit. Monetary authority has control over the decisions regarding the allocation of credit to priority sector and small borrowers. This policy decides over the specified percentage of credit that is to be allocated to priority sector and small borrowers. Next is equitable distribution of credit. The policy of Reserve Bank of India aims equitable distribution to all sectors of the economy and all social and economic class of people. Next is to promote efficiency. It is another essential aspect where the central bank pays a lot of attention. It tries to increase the efficiency in the financial system and tries to incorporate structural changes such as deregulating the interest rates, ease operational constraints in the credit delivery system, to introduce new money market instruments, etc. Reducing the rigidity. RBI tries to bring about the flexibilities in the operations, which provides a considerable autonomy. It encourages more competitive environment and diversification. It maintains its control over the financial system whenever and wherever necessary to maintain the discipline and prudence in operations of the financial system. In this module, we will study about the different goals, instruments, and targets of RBI in detail.
After studying this module, you shall be able to know about different goals, targets, indicators, and instruments of monetary control, understand the connection between number of independent instruments and targets, understand the link between money and policy targets. In recent discussions on the theory of monetary policy, a clear distinction is made among goals, targets, indicators, instruments of monetary policy.
The various intermediate measures may have the potential to serve as intermediate targets and or as intermediate indicators of monetary policy. Targets are obviously enough objectives the Federal Reserve seeks to achieve over some time period with some degree of precision and under some particular set of circumstances. The concept of intermediate measures as monetary indicators is a bit more complicated because it is sometimes taken to mean a measure of the stance of monetary policy and is sometimes interpreted as an indicator of current or future developments in the economy. In much of the earlier literature, early of 1960s, the term was interpreted in the sense of indicators of stance of monetary policy, that is, as measures that could provide, in some sense, an index of monetary ease or restraint. The attempt to pin down such an index produced and indeed continues to produce a certain amount of confusion and ambiguity. Consider, for example, a situation in which the Federal Reserve is using the interest rates as an operating target and has no intermediate target objective for the money stock. Suppose, on entering a recession, the policymakers progressively lower their interest rate target, but owing to the recession-induced decline in the demand for money, the money stock falls, probably along with a drop in the total reserves. Measured in terms of intentionality, policy has clearly eased because the declining short-term rates are at least in large part the direct result of policy decisions to ease. But if one believes that it is not intentionality, but rather the impact of the policy on the economy that matters, and if one also believes that this impact is best signaled by the money stock, then in this instance, the declining money stock indexes not an easing but a tightening of policy. This may be a terminological problem in the sense that one may want to talk about an indicator of policy intentions or an indicator of policy impact, and these may not be the same thing. But the distinction between measures of intention and measures of impact, if they are in fact different, may also raise an econometric issue: how to decide which intermediate measure, if any, should be treated as predetermined for estimating purposes. In any case, the recent technical literature has tended to focus on intermediate indicators, sometimes in this context also called information variables, not as the measures of the stance of policy, but as the measure of the present or prospective state of the economy. Clearly, the main requirement for a good intermediate indicator of the state of the economy is that it be reliability or predictability related to the current or prospective behavior of the ultimate goals, such as inflation or real output. In practice, statistical tests have often been couched in terms of the relationship of the measures to the nominal GNP. A question arises whether a measure that has proved to be a good indicator in this sense can then be used as an intermediate target while still continuing to be a good indicator. It has sometimes been asserted that when a financial aggregate such as the money stock becomes an intermediate target, presumably chosen in part because of its good indicator properties, these properties will then be altered by the very fact of its targeting by the authorities. This may or may not be a problem with respect to the financial aggregates that are treated both as intermediate targets and indicators. It clearly could be a complicating issue, however, for such market measures as commodity prices, interest rates, and the foreign exchange rate. Knowledge in the market that the behavior of the measure is being used by the authorities to make policy decision is very likely to alter that behavior.
The goals of RBI are maximum feasible output, high rate of growth, full employment, price stability, greater equality in the distribution of income and wealth, healthy balance in the balance of payments. RBI has the following targets to achieve their different goals: money supply, bank credit, interest rates. The different indicators of monetary policy control are high-powered money, money supply, bank credit, interest rates. Instruments that can be used in monetary controls are open market operations, variation in reserve requirements, reserve bank credit to banks, cost availability, statutory liquidity requirement, selective credit controls. RBI faces two types of policy problem. First, they has to control the money supply, and secondly, it is required to alter the money supply in response to changes in the economy. In 1952, economist Ian Tinbergen pointed out that to achieve a certain number of targets requires at least the same number of instruments as targets. Moreover, if the targets are distinct, the instruments must exert distinct influences on them. Thus, one target can be achieved with one instrument, two targets with two instruments, and so on, provided the instruments exert distinct influences on the targeted variables. Let us now understand the impact of instruments on the RBI's ability to achieve targets with the help of the aggregate demand and supply diagram. For this, we are taking price level on y-axis and real GDP on x-axis. The economy is initially at the intersection of AD and SRAS at point A, with a price level of P0 and real output of Y0. We assume the policymaker has two targets, one for the price level and one for the real output. The target for the price level is PT and the target for output is YT, as indicated by point T in the figure. How can policy move the economy from its initial equilibrium at point A to the target equilibrium at point T? The answer depends upon the number and effects of RBI's policy instruments on supply and demand. Let us assume that the RBI has available two instruments, one that can shift aggregate demand and one that can shift aggregate supply. Then the move from the equilibrium at point A to the equilibrium at point T requires shifting aggregate demand to the right from AD to AD1 and shifting aggregate supply to the right from SRAS to SRAS1. If the RBI changes its instruments appropriately to shift aggregate demand and supply in this manner, and if no other changes in variable occurs that influence aggregate demand and supply, the economy will reach the target equilibrium at point T. Thus, in this example, two instruments, one that changes aggregate demand and one that changes aggregate supply, are sufficient to achieve two targets. Now we will see whether RBI can achieve the target equilibrium of point T, given that it is able to shift only the aggregate demand curve. In figure, the economy is at initial equilibrium where AD and SRAS intersects at point A, with a price level of P0 and an output level of Y0. Suppose the target price level and output are PT and YT respectively, as given by point T. The RBI can achieve the targeted price level of PT by shifting aggregate demand to AD3. But the equilibrium at point D achieves the price level target with output YD, which is below the target level of YT. The RBI can achieve output level YT by shifting aggregate demand to AD2, but the equilibrium at point C achieves the output target with a price level PC, that is, above the target price level. Finally, the RBI may choose equilibrium such as point B with a price level of PB and an output level of YB. Here, both price and output targets are missed, but the output miss is less than at point D and the price level miss is less than at point C. Notice, though, that all points lie on the original aggregate supply curve, SRAS. It is the inability to shift SRAS that forces the RBI to choose between hitting one target and missing the other target by a relatively large margin, such as at point C or D, and missing both targets by a relatively smaller margin, such as at point B. Both the graphs shows the Timbergen's claim that it is not merely the number of instruments that is important, but the number of instruments exerting independent effects on the target variables. With no instrument to control aggregate supply, the RBI is unable to achieve both a price level target and an output target. We say the RBI faces a shortage of policy instruments, since it lacks enough instruments to achieve its targets. For this reason, the RBI is always trading off the achievement of one set of goals for the achievement of another. Now we will take second policy problem in discussing how the RBI should change the money supply to deal with economic upheavals. It is important to keep the underlying economic model in mind. Remember that we have two models, a long run model with vertical aggregate supply and a short run model with upward sloping aggregate supply. The effects of changes in the money supply differ in these models. Let us now start with the long-run model with vertical aggregate supply. The RBI can achieve the target price level PT in the long run when the aggregate supply curve is vertical. In the figure, if the initial equilibrium is at point A, RBI can increase the money supply to cause aggregate demand to shift from AD to ADT to reach the target price level. If the initial equilibrium is at point B, the RBI can decrease the money supply to lower aggregate demand from AD1 to ADT. Let us discuss another case when output level target greater than Y0. In the long run, output is determined by the vertical aggregate supply curve. The RBI has no control over aggregate supply and hence has no way to achieve a higher output level target. This is illustrated in figure. The economy starts in equilibrium at point A. With a price level of P0 and an output level of Y0, the target level of output YT is above Y0. In an effort to increase output towards the target level, the RBI might increase. Now, we will discuss the short-run model with upward-sloping aggregate supply. Here, the economy starts in equilibrium at point A, with price level P0 and output Y0. The target level of output is YT. Now, the RBI can increase the money supply, thereby shifting aggregate demand to the right and moving the equilibrium to point T, where output equals the target YT. Hence, we have achieved the output target. Let us understand the position of the short-run aggregate supply curve. It is influenced by the fact that input prices are held constant and the level of input prices is determined largely by expectations about the price level. When workers and firms expect a rising price level, they are more likely to agree to rising nominal wage rates. Thus, expectations about the actions of monetary policymakers are important. If workers expect the RBI to attempt to raise the price level to reduce their real wage and increase output, they are likely to demand higher nominal wages, shifting short-run aggregate supply to the left and countering some or all of the influence of monetary policy. Thus, policymakers cannot regard the short-run aggregate supply curve as fixed and must be concerned about shifts in short-run aggregate supply curve.
Let us now summarize what we have learned in this module. Intermediate measures, whether considered as targets or as indicators, are variable that, as the term suggests, are intermediate between first the instruments and operating targets that are capable of rather tight control, and second the ultimate target measures that can only be influenced indirectly. Short-term interest rates are usually treated as operating targets but may also be treated as intermediate targets. The monetary base is most often discussed as an intermediate measure, but sometimes more controversially is viewed as a potential operating target. The concept of intermediate measures as monetary indicators is a bit more complicated because it is sometimes taken to mean a measure of the stance of monetary policy and is sometimes interpreted as an indicator of current or future developments in the economy. Clearly, the main requirement for a good intermediate indicator of the state of the economy is that it be reliably or predictably related to the current or prospective behavior of the ultimate goals, such as inflation or real output. In practice, statistical tests have often been couched in terms of relationship of the measure to the nominal GNP. To achieve a certain number of targets requires at least the same number of instruments as targets. Moreover, if the targets are distinct, the instruments must exert distinct influences on them. Thus, one target can be achieved with one instrument, two targets with two instruments, and so on, provided the instruments exert distinct influences on the targeted variable. With no instrument to control aggregate supply, the RBI is unable to achieve both a price level target and an output target. We say that the RBI faces a shortage of policy instruments since it lacks enough instruments for achieving its targets. For this reason, the RBI and the politicians are always trading off the achievement of one set of goals for the achievement of the another set of goals. The policy problem the RBI faces is twofold: how to control the money supply and how to alter the money supply in response to the changes in the economy. Policy makers cannot regard the short-run aggregate supply curve as the fixed and must be concerned about shift in the short-run aggregate supply curve as fixed and must be concerned about shifts in short-run aggregate supply curve even in the short run. Thus, we have traced that the impact of Reserve Bank of India with regard to various policy instruments and policy targets both in the short run and in the long run. This analysis has been traced with upward sloping short run aggregate supply curve as well as the long run vertical aggregate supply, thus concluding that the number of instruments under the control of RBI will give freedom to target the same number of policy instruments.